prize. Who is the most famous name in the world? They gave the name of John and Mary and Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply said in the Quran, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرًا. Just 1400 years ago, and just few years back, it was announced on American TV that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the most famous name in the world. But I said that this was not a shocking news at all. Person who was explaining the meaning of peace, the name of the conference that we are in, by teaching people that the essence of peace is that you let people live in peace. You don't harm people by your hand or by even your tongue, let alone by your weapons and by your wealth and by your power. By saying, Al-Muslim, من سلم المسلمون من لسانه ويده. The true Muslim, the true Muslim who surrenders himself to God to live in peace is the one who makes people are safe from his tongue, from his sayings, from talking about him or her, from gossiping, and making the people safe from his hand that punishes, that kills, that tortures, to the level that he spread the culture. If you kill an innocent person, it's considered by God as if you have killed all human beings on the earth. One person, as if you have killed all humans on the earth. What a crime. A person or a leader who taught humanity and benefited humanity by this. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. Whoever does anything that's positive, even it weighs a grain of tiny, small seed, he will see the reward of this by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever does anything that's evil, that's bad, even if it is tiny and small, you will see the compensation for that. These are some of the teachings of this person. By the way, he did not need any single prize. He did not even need people to nominate him to Nobel's prize or any other prize in the world. He even did not apply, or his followers did not apply for a prize for him, because he knew and everybody knew that it is the creator of the heavens and the earth who gave him the best prize on the earth by saying, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you except to be the mercy for all human beings. I'm quite sure that all of you know who is that person. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallahu khaira, Sheikh Dr. Mamdouh Mohamed. We now will have time for question and answers, and the format will just be the same as I had introduced before. So once we are ready, we will have the first question from the front mic.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Sheikh. My name is Mutawassim bin Hussein and I'm a mass media student from Mumbai University. Sheikh, my question is, this was what you said Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, and why are we Muslims not able to promote amongst non-Muslims in the world how he was? I mean, he was the peace-loving person and he was the most noble man, and why are we not able to promote how he was amongst non-Muslims? And if we can, then how should we promote the teachings of Prophet Muhammad amongst non-Muslims?
Thank you, Jazakallah khair, for this wonderful question. He's saying that we know from the lecture that you are talking about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Why shouldn't we promote Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam? I think it's a very important issue, but from many perspectives, one perspective, some of us are promoting it. IRF is promoting it by having these conferences, by making 100 million human beings at least are exposed to know about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We are promoting this, and the best way to promote this is to study his biography and to take him as your role model, and you apply, you become a second or a third or a fourth or a million image of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by acting his teachings on the earth, by showing the beauty of Islam as a representative, as a one who models the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have a role, I have a role, your father has a role, your mother had a role, every Muslim in this world has a role to promote this figure, this Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this mercy for humanity, by acting his teachings in reality. And in this way, when people see how Muslims act, they would know that the reason, or they would make the link between our actions and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in this way, I think we will be guiding a lot of people on the earth to follow the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope I answered the question.
The next question from the sisters.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
In the course of your talk, you said read to know your creator before delving into the sciences. Does this apply in the education of our children today?
It's a wonderful question, and the answer is quite obvious. Definitely. I have seen some people, some Muslims of course, just applying this. The first thing that they would teach their kids after knowing father and mother, they would know about Allah. They'd say that, where is Allah when they're carrying their kids? Where is Allah? They would be pointing to the sky. You can teach this to your kid as early as possible. So you cultivate and you implant the culture of Iman as early as possible. I swear by Allah, in Texas, in one of the masajid, I saw a Bengali brother coming to the mosque, carrying his young daughter on his neck and shoulder like this. She was approximately less than 2 years. And when they entered the mosque, immediately she cried and she pointed to a poster and she said, Allah, 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 because the word Allah was written on it. And he was non-Arabic speaking brother. So when we cultivate this culture as early as possible in our kids, and as every time they grow, and in every speech that we make, and when we make any analysis and any talk, we build up this spirit of knowing Allah as early as possible. This is more important than teaching him how to be a doctor as early as possible. That's what I meant, and that's what I think that Muslims are doing in their houses, alhamdulillah, which is something very good. I hope I answered the question.
The next question from the front mic.
My name is Dr. Ahmed Sheikh, and this is not a question, but this is a comment on your wonderful lecture essay. One author called Michael Hart has written a book, The 100 Most Influential Persons of the World,
in 1989.
And he has covered large number of people right from 4,000 years to present. And that book remained at the bestseller in US quite for about a decade or so. And he has selected 100 persons who have influenced the world in various fields. And he has given the number as per their influence to the people. And when he came to given number 1 and 2 and 3, He was confused whom should be the number one, number two and number three. Number one, he selected Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Number two, he selected Sir Isaac Newton. And number three, Jesus. And he has written in the preface that I was wondering whom I should give the number one. But when I see the influence of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I really feel that he should be given number one, though the writer was a Christian.
Absolutely, thank you. His talk is about the book of Michael Hart. I'm quite sure all of you have heard this. And I think one of the reasons for the success of this book, that this writer was unbiased to his nation or to his religion, but he was fair enough. He took a criteria and applied them. And one of these criteria that he applied was how much the humanity has benefited from the person. And based on this, he found, and this is, by the way, the same criteria that was selected by Nobel Prize. However, the results was different because some people are biased and some people are not biased. Michael Hart reached this conclusion that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the one who has benefited humanity to the end or to the maximum, or he benefited humanity more than anyone else on the earth benefited humanity. Yes, we know that some people, some Christians, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them, they are fair and just, and this is the result. When you are fair, you will say the truth, because it's very obvious, no matter how it is against what your belief is. I hope I answered the question, and thank you for the comment.
The next question from the front mic.
My name is Dr. Ahmed Sheikh, and this is not a question, but these are comments on your wonderful lecture has said. One author called Michael Hart has written a book, The 100 Most Influential Persons of the World,
in 1989.
And he has covered large number of people, right from 4,000 years to prison. And that book remained at the best seller in US quite for about a decade or so. And he has selected 100 persons who have influenced the world in various fields. And he has given the number as per their influence to the people. And when he came to given number 1 and 2 and 3, he was confused. Whom should be the number 1, number 2 and number 3? Number 1, he selected Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Number 2, he selected Sir Isaac Newton. And number 3, Jesus. And he has written in the preface that I was wondering whom I should give the number 1. But when I see the influence of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I really feel that he should be given number 1, though the writer was a Christian.
Absolutely, thank you. His talk is about the book of Michael Hart. I'm quite sure all of you have heard this. And I think one of the reasons for the success of this book, that this writer was unbiased to his nation or to his religion, but he was fair enough. He took a criteria and applied them. And one of these criteria that he applied was how much the humanity has benefited from the person. And based on this, he found, and this is, by the way, the same criteria that was selected by Nobel Prize. However, the results was different because some people are biased and some people are not biased. Michael Hart reached this conclusion that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the one who has benefited humanity to the end, or to the maximum, or he benefited humanity more than anyone else on the earth benefited humanity. Yes, we know that some people, some Christians, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them, they are fair and just, and this is the result. When you are fair, you will say the truth, because it's very obvious, no matter how it is against what your belief is. I hope I answered the question, and thank you for the comment.
The next question from the sisters.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Brother, with regard to the previous
question. The cultural thing I understand, instilling that sort of awareness of Allah at a young age, taking it to the next level with regards to Islamic education for children as opposed to a regular education, if you could call it that.
Again, the question is very good. It's not just in the early stages. This Islam should be throughout our life. But in the beginning, as the people who develop curriculum say that, in the beginning, the child needs more and needs the basics that are very important, the fundamentals of Islam, or the basics of Islam, which are related to the issues of usually aqeedah, and then comes after that the other issues that are not needed at early stages. So there are, I think, many books in the market. One of them is called مَا لَا يَسْعُ الْمُسْلِمُ جَهْلُهُ, and the minimum amount of Islamic information that is needed by the Muslim. Basically talks about the beliefs, main beliefs, not the detailed beliefs that we're talking about, but the basic beliefs. So this should continue throughout. Now, you may be in a place that the educational system does not provide you with that. And here is the role of the parents. That's why it is a necessity on each one of us. And that's what you're doing now by coming here and by learning more and more about your religion, so that you would disseminate this and benefit others from it. And basically you begin with your children. So in this case, if you have this level of Islamic education in the place where you live, and you cannot afford traveling, and you cannot afford doing this and this, at least you would provide the missing parts that are missing from the educational system, and you keep educating your child until he or she would be able to read by himself and herself, and would be able to educate themselves. But as long as they are young and they are growing, they still need your guidance and direction to guarantee that the amount of Islamic knowledge they have would be able to save them from deviation from the main path or the mainstream of Islam. I hope I answered your question.
Zakallah.
The next question from the front mic.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
Is it possible for a person who is spreading peace throughout the world by giving lectures, writing books, holding conferences like this to get a Nobel Prize for peace? I refer to Uncle Dr. Zakir Naik.
Jazakallah khair. Are you promoting to make Dr. Zakir Naik as a candidate for Peace Prize? Yeah. If not, who else? This is my answer, as brief as possible. If not Dr. Zakir Naik, who else would be promoted to be a winner of Peace Prize? I support your viewpoint, and I'm quite sure that all of us support this viewpoint, and I hope that the committee that selects the winners would listen to us and would consider Dr. Zakir Naik for Peace Prize.
I pray to God that it should happen as early as possible.
As early as possible. I hope they are watching us on the TV now, or at least on YouTube, and they would consider this. But I think there are some official regulations that should go through. For example, some Muslim organizations would send his name and his works to promote this, and I hope they would consider this, inshallah.
The next question from the sisters.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Nasreen. I'm a doctor by profession. I wanted to ask, nowadays whoever gets a Nobel Prize, it's made into a very big deal by the media. So I wanted to know, is it really a big deal?
I think this is one of the most difficult questions that I have been asked Is it a big deal or small deal? It is a deal. I wouldn't say big or small. It is a deal, and it's something we face. It's a reality in our lifetime. We cannot deny it. But if we can use it, if we can affect the process of selection to make it more unbiased, more fair, and more just to all human beings, we would be doing a wonderful thing. Otherwise, it's not within our hands. But we would like the world to know that among the Muslims, there are inventors and there are peace promoters, there are many capacities and talents. And I think, inshallah, one day they will realize this, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan for this suggestion, and I hope that the committee of selection would respond to your call very soon, Dr. Nasreen.
The next question from the front mic.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh. I'm Siddiq Ghaniwala. I'm doing research on Islamic investment banking and finance. My question is, recently you must have heard, you know, the Nobel Prize for the Peace was awarded to Barack Obama. This was a serious question about the Nobel Prize, now the credibility part. This is what I feel personally. Secondly, the question is, now we have been seeing last 102 years been passed away, and very few Muslims have been actually been given this Nobel Prize. There are some analysis which has been done, and we identify the problem is there is no real community from the community side. You know, the research work has not been pushed up by the community across, and education, as you said, is the second issue. But what I feel is that across international level, there should be some forum which should promote the research, Islamic researchers and scholars, to actually get this type of awards. At least not, but at least named at the international level.
Yeah. So, what is the question? Are you telling us that Muslims should...
Correct.
Okay. His first comment was about Mr. Barack Obama. And I think before he even shed some doubts about it, a lot of newspapers in the world raised this question by saying, what for? He got the prize and they said, what for? What are the things that he had done that he deserved this? And this is, I think, throwing a lot of questions about the credibility of the prize and the people who are behind it, because at least they are saying it's too early to make this quick judgment. I think this was the message that all the media addressed. Regarding why shouldn't we Muslims promote some or make some prizes, I think there are many prizes. One of the prizes that you need to be aware of is the King Faisal Prize. And there's another one is also Naif Prize in Saudi Arabia. And there are some others in Kuwait and some Gulf countries. And I'm sure that there are some prizes, but they do not have the name and the fame that Nobel Prize, for example, has. So it is our role as well to participate in these prizes and to talk about them. And I hope one time I would be able to talk about these prizes so that Muslims would be aware of them and would participate in them and would promote the people who deserve to take these prizes, inshallah.